religious controversy. The religious controversy really stems from the fact, what's your religion? What's your nationality? And we as a people should understand the depth of what's your nationality? What's your religion? It goes way back before Prophet Nobu Ali came. When the slaveholder beat Kula Kinte and made him Togi. When he told the Negroes on the plantation, you can't say your own name, your own language. Then he divided us from our religion, became the controversy. Since that time, we have been running around to people trying to say what our religion is on our own, like we know better. But what we actually been doing is switching from one slaveholder to another. We go from Christianity, from Judaism. The Jews sold us into slavery. They came out of Egypt, and it tells you in the Bible, in Leviticus, that they can enslave the people that came out of Egypt with them. Then if you get into Christianity, say we're cursed people. From Ham, we're cursed people. Then you get into Islam, they tell you Muhammad's the last prophet. And while they hold the Quran up in there and say Allahu Akbar, they had their foot on our neck. They held us in slavery in Arabia up to 1962. Now I had some people tell me, well, Brother Roy, you know the original Arabs, they were black, they was Moors. Now I had to tell them you a lie. The original Arabs was not Moors. It's impossible. It's so impossible that I put up the scripture. Psalms 83, verse 6. It says the Ishmaelites on the land of the Moabites. It didn't say the Moabites on the land, Ishmaelites. So the Ishmaelites are descendants of Ishmael, who descended of Ibrahim through Hagar. So that lets you know they had to be on our land. We was never on their land. Now, as occupying authorities, they've changed the history of our people. So now we believe in order to be Islamic, we gotta speak Arabic and dye our beards red, wear our pants all the way up to our kneecaps and, you know, speak Arabic. What's the difference between that and Christianity? None. Because the Christian gave you a Christian name, Joe Bob.
Islam. We give praises to our Father God, Allah, for allowing us to see another opportunity, another day, and giving full honors and praises to our Father God, Allah. We woke up this morning, you stretched out, and you was able to take in another breath, to feel in your bodies, to get you prepared, to start your day off. And we trust before your foot hit the floor, before you got fully from under the covers, that you said Allahu Akbar, giving praises to Allah for allowing you to rise up and to gain much more and further your understanding, to fill up and continuously deposit into your spiritual bank account so you can have a fruitful return. We want to humble ourselves. We need to humble ourselves. Everyone should humble themselves and give in total praises to the one true God whom we call Allah. Allahu Akbar, Almighty Allah. He gave us his gift, which is the gift to humanity. And the gift given to humanity came in the noblest image of our beloved Prophet Nobuju Ali. And it was Prophet Nobuju Ali who clarified our understanding, who gave rise to our understanding, who implement an adherence for our understanding to be prescribed and conditioned under that beautiful crescent and star of Islam. And so it was following the dictates that is scribed within the scriptures of our Old Testament, which is what we refer to as our Holy Quran of Mecca, being our Old Testament, is where it states in there in the Quran that every nation shall receive a prophet bringing them the message in their tongue, which means in their understanding, where it is not something foreign or where we have to subscribe to understanding another language to understand the word of God. God doesn't work like that. What is the language of God? Is it Arabic? Is it Aramaic? Is it Latin? Is it Spanish? Is it German? Is it English? What is the language of God? And it is noted within the Quran of Mecca that a prophet will come to his people, bringing the message to his people in their language, in their native tongue. And we give praises to our Father God Allah for bringing a prophet that was raised amongst his own, one who gave us our own, connected us back to our own identity, our own true selves. He retrofitted us back to the original conception and idea from what we was created. Praise to Allah. Praises to Allah, honors to his beloved prophet, Noble Jew Ali, the first and only American-born prophet in this era and time. We want to extend honors to Marcus Gavi, the prophet's forerunner. Beautiful demonstration about Marcus Messiah Garvey given to our national leadership from Booker T. Bay, who was one of the oldest members in the Moorish Science Temple of America, because he first started off as a Garveyite. And thus hearing the prophet, when Garvey introduced to his followers that a man is going to come to you tomorrow that I can't lace up his shoes, it was T. Booker Bay that said, I'm going to be here tomorrow to hear this demonstration. Who is it that you, Marcus Messiah Garvey, a man that you can't lace up his shoes? Who is this person? So with that sure curiosity, T. Booker Bay returned to hear the words, the wisdom, the divine measure coming from our beloved prophet, Noble Jew Ali. And he gave this demonstration to our leadership in explaining to him. And that is one of the primal things that we are so blessed within our community. There is no one, there is no elder that has been consistent, that is presently consistent on the internet, that has been in the temple for as long as our Supreme Grand Sheikh has been, that is constantly pounding it into where it's a part, very part, for all those who have ears to hear, not your physical ear hearing, but the spiritual aspect of you hearing and taking in the lessons. And it is a blessing that our Supreme Grand Sheikh, Sheikh Ras Sadiq, whom we give honors to, preserved the history, every facet of a conversation, the teachings, his time spent under the tutelage, not just visiting or stopping by or having a word or two with someone that was taught directly by the prophet, but was an actual student of those taught by the prophet himself. Our Supreme Grand Sheikh can honestly, without doubt, unequivocally, can say that he has empirical evidence of Prophet Noble Jew Ali, because he experienced the wisdom, the love, the dedication, the mental and spiritual mindset of those individuals that was with the prophet by sitting and listening to their lessons, but also feeling the spirit of the words in which they talk and they recall of the lessons of our beloved Prophet Noble Jew Ali. That's someone who has experience from those who got firsthand evidence of our prophet. There's no one that is existing that's close to that. There's no one out there that is doing this. And so we want to extend those honors to our chief of ministers And in honoring our chief of ministers, we will be hosting a special webinar lecture, the students of Sheikh Ra Sadi El. So everyone who has been engaged in our Holyday service, Sunday school, our YouTube channel, actually in conversations, not with just the chief minister, but his students, to hear the mindset of the students, to hear the mindset of the students that sat under the teacher for years. So we want to give honors to our Sheikh Ra Sadi El. We want to extend honors to all true and faithful Moorish American Muslims this day, saying Islam, Islam, Islam. I'm Grand Governess Isis Sadi El. This is the Moorish Science Temple of America, 1928 style. That's the Moorish Temples of Islam. We want to extend Islam to our family, our Moorish family, our friends, our sympathizers, all those in the sound of my voice, whether you're looking at this live or in the morning, the afternoon, or evening, we extend high Islams to you. Blessed, blessed, holy day. And we say blessed, holy day because we put a greater heighten. We heighten the experience. We heighten our responsibility. We heighten the connection of our thoughts and our words to be under the sanction of our Father God Allah. Happy is a general emotion. People are happy and doing naught. People are happy at happy hour right now. And so when you put blessed in front of anything, that's saying that Allah signed off on that. Without a doubt or contradiction, we give honors to all true and faithful Moorish American Muslims this day. Blessed holy day to you and yours. Well, we do have a dinger, and I'm going to speak on the scenario that we want to share with you. And the scenario of this is with is to let you know that one, what if you've been told all these years that after being in the temple for whether 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20 years, that everything you know was a lie. Everything that you was taught was a lie. What would you do? What would you do? What if everything you have been told about the Moorish Science Temple of America was a lie? What would you do? How would you place yourself in the truth? So let's have a conversation about that. And I speak on that because we have bear witness to, and even using our own self as an example of having been led by false information, outright lies about the Prophet in the Moorish Science Temple of America. And once discovering that, it wasn't where we was questioning the source in which was feeding the lie. We click to get the heck up out of there. What am I going to talk about? What are we going to get out or gain from someone giving us an explanation as to why they lied to us? So, in that, when I was told, a mistruth about the Moorish Science Temple of America, it was about placing ourselves in search of a better understanding. Having received the Circle 7 Quran and then placing that as a gauge when I asked people about the Prophet and many of the lessons, definitely knowing needing a teacher to bring understanding, no one would give me understanding of this booklet, this divine works compiled by a prophet. I would get all kind of different summaries and explanations, but nothing that inspired me, that ignited a sense of yearning, a connection to a greater understanding. And so we, and as many know, the chief minister has been lied to about the Moorish Science Temple of America, and he shared his experience and what happened. He shared how he watched Moors fight to the death. He actually saw a brother with his eye on a shank. This is in Chicago's prisons, fighting over a lie. And then we have bear witness when hearing someone that recognized that they've been lied to for over 20 years say, what are we going to do about it now? I'm too old to try to learn anything else. I'm used to this, you know. We'll just figure it out as we go. So now you have these that have become complacent in the lie. So they're comfortable. We have seen brothers lead services within the state and federal prisons for years talk about how no one has come in there with Qurans. They had received no help, outside help from temples. They wrote many temples across the country, called across the country. The only ones that answered their letters and answered their calls was the Moorish Science of America, 1928. And I remember going into this federal prison. I can't remember which one it was. I believe it was in West Virginia. And it was a packed room, maybe close to 70 inmates. And I remember explaining, we had our books, explaining some general teachings about the prophet. And I remember explaining to them, you know, because they wanted to turn to the east and pray. And I said, that's not how the prophet did it. You know how we know? Because our teacher was taught by the man who was taught by the prophet. Point blank, period. So we don't have to question whether or not it's true or not. Those that was with the prophet, not just one, but all of them, they ain't turned to the east to pray. And so they would turn to the east and pray. And I said, brothers, that's not even logical in who we are. And then you talk about security wise, your back's all turned. You don't know what's going on. The prophet faced the people faced the prophet, and we opened up with the congregational prayer. Then they say to me, well, sister, seems like you got some type of foreign teaching. Y'all the ones facing the east. And you're talking about I got a foreign teaching? Okay. And then to make an insult to injury, they said that, I said, well, it was a demonstration I gave, and it led up to that Allah doesn't love everybody. That's brother said, there's nowhere in this Quran that says that Allah doesn't love everybody. That Allah loves everything, everyone. So now here's that Christian thing. Allah loves all the sinners and the winners. But it was Allah that destroyed cities. Allah sent floods. My chapter 35 says, the raft, beware. We can go in the Quran of Mecca, go in the Bible. It's no good and evil aspect into this. Mm. It's only but one way in Islam. It's the right way. And so they was offended by that. So the next day they wind up folding up a piece of paper and sit it across the podium and said, sister, you're going to demonstrate on that. I unfolded the paper. I'm like, now this is one prison that happened to where I don't think the chief was with me with this one. Because the last one we was in Yazoo and the brothers demonstrated, he shook the room, scared some of the brothers out the room. Because they was facing the east after we told them how to open up. And the chief stopped me and said, what the hell is going on here? What are we doing this for? We done drove 6 hours for y'all not to listen to the truth? They ain't paying us that much money to come here. And so brothers started sneaking out. Nation of Islam was smiling. They was like, Islam, right on. They was, because they saw the strength behind someone not accepting a lie to be manifested in front of them. And so many times we've seen brothers get the truth, know the truth about the prophet, but because the lie allows them to keep doing what they're doing, the lie doesn't conform them to the strict adherence, the lie doesn't make them repent. The lie allows them to continue to do what they do, and they can still wear their turban and fez and kufis. They can still wear their charm, say Islam all day long, but live a lie and be comfortable in that. Be comfortable in that. So it's not even, they're not even in pre-contemplation. When people that's in addiction, they're not even in pre-contemplation or going into contemplation. You know, when you're thinking about, you know what? Something ain't right about this. And then move on to that idea that something ain't right about this and get with the truth. They're not even in that. They just totally turned blindsided to the lie because that's all they know. And that's all they want to know. But I definitely want to extend honors to someone. And as I turn the cook over to our leader, was that it was a letter written by an actual member who was a top officer in Jones Bay's, under Arleville and then Jones Bay. Top officer. He was a grand governor, state of North Carolina. 20 years under that lie. In one conversation, he heard decades of truth that shattered that lie like a brick through a pane glass window. From that moment on, that brother was in search. It was like he was, somebody gave, put smelling salt up under his nose. He was open wide like a peppermint. And not once did our Supreme Grand Sheik said, brother, well, you need to stop hanging with them liars and come with the truth. Not once. He said, ask them. He said, aren't you going to convention in a couple of weeks? Ask them. Ask them. And he shares in a letter that he written, which is called The Exodus, My Exodus Out of the Moorish Science of America Incorporated. And in that whole, his personal demonstration with that, he went to the historian, Warner Bay, Sister Warner Bay, the historian, and asked her a question about the history in Kirtland Bay. And she basically capitulated.
She said he was smart and everybody knew what everything needed to be done. So he changed the movement.
So she basically admitted that Kirtland Bay changed the entire movement. They created something totally different. And he was flabbergasted. And y'all okay with that? She's like, what are you going to do about it now? And so that whole grand body, at least the top officers, they know they live in a lie. And people continuously follow them because guess what? The lie has become so comfortable right now because it doesn't make us accountable. And we cool with it. And they're cool with it. But this brother said, I ain't cool with it. He said, honestly, I don't feel safe here. A lie ain't nowhere in this picture. I don't feel safe. Y'all can sing all the we are Muslims marching along. Y'all can sing all the more songs all day long. Ain't gonna make it right. And because a lie has been told so long and believed by so many, doesn't make it right. Point blank, period. And if the lie makes you comfortable and the truth offends you in some kind of way, you gone. There ain't no return for you other than just to repeat this scenario over and over and over again. So it's like you put yourself in the faith and take yourself out the faith. You put yourself in the faith and you wiggle all around and do the hokey pokey and continuously do that song and dance routine over and over again. So y'all keep hokey pokeying it in the more scientific America. Putting your right foot in and taking it out and shaking all about, it still ain't gonna make right or the lie into a truth. You gotta stop living a lie and move into the truth. So we turn it over to our teacher. this one. Mm-hmm.
Good thing you told me, right?
I said I turned over my teacher.
I wasn't paying no attention. The other way, if I was saying something, you still be running off at the mouth. I don't understand.
Islam.
Ah, buddy. Whew. Islam. Oh, I rise in all perfect praise to Allah, honor to His holy prophet, Jew Ali, who's Allah in the person of us. Islam, pardon me. You know, I was listening to ISIS talk about the prison, and I'm just amazed, you know, because really, it seems like as a people, we didn't get dumber than smarter. You know, when I was in prison, we would go to the library and look stuff up. You know, we would pull all types of stuff together. You know, Mo, what's that there, Mo? We said, well, Mo, what you gonna look? I'm gonna look up this here, Mo. Okay, let's look this up and see how this look with this here. Let's see how it relates to this here. Moors don't do that. I was talking with a Moor recently, and so he's from prison. We was talking. And so I said, give me 15 questions, brother. And I answered, face said, okay. So why? We're waiting for the 15 questions. I said, you know, who were you? He told me he studied under McDowell bed one time, then Hopkins bed another time, and this and that. So I asked him some basic questions. I said, well, let me ask you this here. Let them dogs in, I said. You know, I said, well, let me ask you this here. How does that work? Because one of his people asked, get upstairs! Hey. One of the people asked this question. Well, y'all not equal, you know. What, y'all a different division? You know, and I was just thinking, you know, why don't Moors follow the prophet instructions? And this is what gets me. Why don't Moors follow the prophet instructions? They were the prophet said. I love this here. Said, what shall we call it? And in this pamphlet, what shall we call it? Which is really called Moorish Literature. The prophet said, it appears a good idea for those who duty is to write for the very journal to find out what is the national name of the forefather of these people. Also look in the history of the founders of civilization and see who they were and where they stood in the building of pre-civilization, of the present civilization. Probably 2 hours in the up-to-date library will serve to relieve what? The strain on their brain. Now you would think, now that was said back in 1928-29, you would think that Moors would be special in that. Plus, that's the very first article in the Moors literature. Probably 2 hours. Now, what we used to do, we was in prison, we get together and go to the library, pull up our stuff, and we would contact people on the streets, ask for questions, etc. So when the brother started asking me a question about the difference in temple, I'm like, what makes you think you're in the right temple? Because you have not done no comparative study. Now, there's a thing in Black Law Dictionary, it's called state of voluntary ignorance. Yeah. Now I'm gonna read it to you. Now you in prison. You ain't got nothing but time. And not only you got nothing but time, we call prison the dismal crypts. What did Jesus do in the dismal crypts? He studied. So let's just see what is a state of voluntary ignorance. Let's go ahead first. Let me see if I can find that state of voluntary ignorance. Okay. I'm really beginning to believe brothers are afraid to study like they should. Okay, status. Because you'll study some stuff from some knuckleheads. You'll study some stuff from the sovereignty group. Now you'll study all that, but you won't study what the prophet said. See statues. Excuse me. I believe I got it up in there. State affairs. State cases, state taxes. Okay. I can't find a state stationery company. Didn't look at voluntary debt. Oh, it's one of my books. But voluntary ignorance, state of voluntary ignorance. Voluntary ignorance. This exists where a party might, by taking reasonable pains, have required the necessary knowledge, but it neglected to do so. So this means you're too damn lazy. Voluntary ignorance. So I get to talking to the brother, so I'm explaining something to the brother. So I try to give him a reference point. I say, you know, it's like chapter 40, verse 6, you know. We as a pure and clean Indian, I desire to marry a pale skinned nation, Europe, etc. And I say, you know, you have to go in your Bible, brother. And in your Bible, Genesis 6,
verse 1.
And it says this here. Let's find out why the prophets say you shouldn't integrate. Go on to Genesis 6, verse 1. And it says, and it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and the daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and took of them wives of all whom they knew. No women. Now, say, the sons of God saw the daughters of men and seen they was fair. What's the difference here? Now, some people say, oh, they said they was just enough. This is what the brother told me. They was just.
You don't see nobody just. When I look at you from a distance, I'm walking up on you, I don't see if you just.
The relationship has to be started. Right.
So now, let's see. what fair means.
I ain't going to pick up other big dictionaries. I'm not mud wrestling with them.
There you go. That's the Quran. I got so many of them. Let me see. You got a dictionary over there? I want a small. I want the big one.
I can find it.
Well, you go get the big one. Give me the big one there.
You gonna carry one hand?
Yeah. Now I want y'all to see what this is. You see this? See this? This is my dictionary for big head scientists like me. Let's see what do fair means. Let's look at what. Now, for some of y'all that didn't see the movie Malcolm X, y'all won't understand. But for some of y'all that watched Malcolm X, fair, complexion, fair, beautiful, pleasant, fair, of a light color, not dark. A musky, blonde, as fair complexion, fair hair. That's what you're trying to. Yeah, she had good hair. That ain't what it's saying. It didn't say nothing about her damn hair.
What?
The brother told me though the hair was straight. It don't say nothing about that.
She had perm.
She must have perm because I had gel. All right, so now fair means here. Blonde, let's see what white meant. Mm. See, this will get me. Now, what got me was the brother told me how they hold me up, but then he got to say, well, brother, I have to respectfully disagree with you. How you gonna disagree with something you just heard? You ain't did no investigation. How you gonna disagree with something you just heard? Ain't like he was studying this yesterday. White. They got so much white here. White boyism. I just seen that word. White boyism. The principle and practice of white boys.
Is that what it says?
I'm reading it. I'm reading it. That's the first time I read that. This book heavy, too. It says, you got a lot of stuff on white. It says,
a lot of stuff on black, too.
White, the color of pure snow or milk, the color of radiant, transmitting, or reflective light containing all of the visible rays of the spectrum. Our American color, opposite to black, whiteness. Especially fairness of complexion, purity, innocence. A white or light colored part. But I like this white. White. To make white, to whiten. White black. A canvas duck. White bait. But this really got me. It says white boy. A member of an illegal association of peasants formed in Ireland about 1760 to resist taxes and tithe collection, and the extortion of their landlord. They made night raids during which they covered their entire body with white shirts, to enable them to distinguish each other. White boyism, the principle and practice of white boy. It must be the Klan, right? Because mm-hmm. they wore white down, right? Mm-hmm. I'll put this back
on. Oh, vanilla ice.
Oh, vanilla ice.
Definitely vanilla ice.
So, this is what gets me. The problem is you come into the temple Christian. You come, I told a brother that one, I ain't no Christian. I said, brother, I bet you took off, waited for Easter and plied it on Easter. I bet you plied on Christmas what you gonna do.
Gotcha.
You anticipated that. It's a day off. It's a day you relax. What you gonna do? You gonna go somewhere with your girlfriend, do something stupid. The problem with Moors is they do everything but the right thing most of the time. They won't study. When someone like me, and you challenging someone like me, and I got a library, I got a whole kitchen library, I got over 2,000-3,000 books. You see some of my dictionaries. I got all types of size of Qurans. Look at that. By different people, different Muslims. I got something on everything, and I study every day. But yet, you don't study every day. And those that do study, study stuff like civics. Now, why is it then that you have an issue when I say something? That's what I ask people. Why do you have an issue when I say something? See? And I'd be like, why? What's this, ISIS? Oh, okay. So. That shows you don't listen. The reason don't listen to me because why I'm a voice of reasoning. You are in your head have the devil dealing with you. I remember when I was a child, you had a cartoon, the angel on this side, the devil on that side, and I'll see which one got you here. And you're the first person to say, I should have followed my first mind. I said it too when I was stupid. I say it now sometimes when I question what I did. But you just heard what I said. I mean, you just heard it. And I'm showing you what I'm talking about. I'm explaining to you words. My beloved brother, Morale, just sent me a book that I was looking for called The Islamicization of Knowledge. Now, I left it upstairs, but I'm going to show you something. Look, our prophet did. This is just one of my folders of quick picks. You know, I got stuff in here that I bring down because I be working on this stuff upstairs. I'm working on a ton of stuff upstairs. And part of what I work on deals with the issues at hand. And so now I want to get this out. This is at the library I got. Like I say, I go to the library and research. And this is the little thing in one of the books I got. It's called The Islamicization of Knowledge. Although the phrase Islamization of Knowledge is a recent one, the general impetus behind it is not new. The recurrent need to view the approach to knowledge reality within the Islamic frame is actively whenever a Muslim scholar perceives a serious threat to Islam and needs to reemphasize his border. In times of political uncertainty and change, this need is greatness. Thus, now check it. So now, see that? Now I'm going to read this here. I got this. Morals versus ethics means both morality and ethics loosely have to do with distinguishing the difference between good and bad, right and wrong. Many people think of morality as something that is personal and normative, whereas ethics is the standards of good and bad distinguished by a certain community or social setting. Now check what it says. Distinguished by a certain community. Now check this out. Hold this up there, Mom. Now I'm going to show the front of this. Show them the front. Okay. Now show them the back, what I got on the back. This is you and me. This is how we started off. Somebody gave you a little devil, and that became your best friend. That secondary thought, that thought that you listen to more than the first thought. And the more you exercise that tiny thought, it gets bigger. And you become comfortable with it. You begin to walk the streets with it, go to your girlfriend's house with everything. But look, it gets bigger. And then suddenly turn around and say, shut up! You say, well, who are you talking to? Then you realize the monster that you have created. Mm-hmm. By your community standards, your devil is personal. See, by your community standards, when you stand up and try to talk, you have no Islamic mindset. You don't even have a Moorish mindset. Because if you had a Moorish mindset, you would stop and think. The prophet said, if I could get you to think. So the Moorish mindset is thinking intelligently, religiously, soundly. And it's based on what the prophet brought. Let me show you. I guess I'll start answering some of this brother's question. So this is a question that the brother gave me. One, Morocco is one country in Africa. So why are we all Moors and not Moors from Morocco? Nigerians from Nigeria, Kenyans from Kenya. I don't even understand that.
That sounds like an 8-year-old.
Now I'm trying to figure this out. Because this guy asked me, Morocco is one country in Africa. So why are we all Moors and not Moors from Morocco? Nigeria from Nigeria, Kenyans from Kenya. I'm like, you didn't study the prophet's teaching. See, this is the first thing I had to ask myself. Where did you formulate this question from? What did the prophet say? Key 12. I mean, key 14. Why are we Moorish Americans?
We're descendants of Moroccans and born in America.
Wait. But the brothers asked me about this, right? He don't have a key 12. They ain't got a key 12. Because key 12 say, why are we Moorish Americans? Because we're descendants of Moroccans and born in America, right? Key 12.
Somebody asked the prophet that. He said, you know what? I'm going to make key 12.
Yeah. Somebody probably came and had the prophet that dumb question. Prophet said, wait, I'm going to write this in black and white. I'm tired of you.
Sick of
you. I'm getting sick of you. Oh yeah, but we're prophet. Why we ain't Moroccans? I'm gonna show you. All you have to do is go find out when did Morocco come about. I mean, let's be stupid. Was America always here? America must always been here because this is a continent, right? So before they called it America, it was something, right? Mm-hmm. People lived here, right? Mm-hmm. People brushed their teeth here, doodled in the bushes here, mm-hmm. chased the deers and the antelopes around here.
Talk crazy.
They talked crazy to each other, killed each other. Before the European came, right? Was it called America then? Let me see. So, now, according to the record, Morocco didn't come in existence to 700. Let me see. Let me make sure. 17 or something like that. 700. And how it wind up getting his name. Let me see. How it got his name was from the people that was already there, basically. But let me see. What year was the country of Morocco founded? Wait, I gotta do it this way because I want them to hear me.
789 AD.
Wait, but don't say it. I'm sorry. Man, go sit in the closet. I'm doing the teaching. All right. Let's see what it says. Okay. What year was the country of Morocco founded?
The founding date of Morocco was 789 AD.
What was Morocco before 1956? A French protectorate, also a period was French ruled by the colony. What country was Morocco before? Morocco was a French protectorate, 1912 to 1956. Okay. What was Morocco called before it was called Morocco? Morocco was the Kingdom of Marrakesh under three dynasties that made Marrakesh their capital, is known as the Kingdom of Fez after the dynasty which has Fez as their capital. Wait a minute now. Are Moroccans and Arabs or Africans? Moroccans are primary Arabs and Berbers originally as in other neighboring countries. Arabs make up 67% of the population of Morocco, while Berbers make up 31%. Saudi make up social. They are two contrasting groups of Moroccans, those living in the city and those living in rural areas. Now,
Arabization.
Now, I have some books around here. Let me see. Let me go behind there and get one. Because I know they don't do no research. They don't go to the library, even in prison. Even in a federal prison. You don't do no research. Huh? Look, I went behind my desk and got a book. Show this book. What's the name of that book, Mark?
Story of Nations.
All right. I don't let y'all know I got it from because I stole it.
Joshua.
I five-fingered quick getaway with it.
See? Five-finger borrowed.
Yeah. Yeah, I borrowed it with five fingers. Yeah. I just want y'all to see how you should study since you don't study. I have a teaching, a book, that shows you how to study. Hold that over, Mom.
I don't have it right
there. Oh, you got it right there, okay. Show it.
Okay, well, tech savvy.
You can barely see it, I see. You go show it in front of me. Yeah. Hold it a little bit closer. Bring it closer. Closer. Up. Bring it up. Raise it up.
What's good?
Bring it a little closer. Okay. Now, can y'all see that subtitle? What did the subtitle say, Mo? Just turn around and look at it. What did it say?
The Moors brought their civilization to Spain.
The who?
The Moors brought their civilization to
Spain. Where they come from? They brought it, huh? What did it read?
It says the Moors conquered Spain and made it prosperous. At this point in the story of the Iberian Peninsula, something happened in Spain which promoted culture and learning, while the other European countries were still living in the Dark Ages. To understand what occurred, we must recall the story of Muhammad, which you read in part 6. At the beginning of the 7th century, Muhammad gave a new faith to the Arabs who lived on the great Arabian desert. His followers pushed across northern Africa, taking the Islamic faith with them. Less than 100 years after Muhammad had given his new religion to the world, one band of his followers, known as the Moors, stood ready to cross the narrow strait of the Gibraltar and carry their religion and civilization into Europe.
Keep going.
Early in the 8th century, the Moors from North Africa made what we would now call an amphibious landing at Gibraltar. The Gobs put up a sturdy resistance, but it was useless. Soon, nearly all of Spain was overturned by the Moors. Here's a first-hand description of the Moors given by an author who has sympathized with the Christian inhabitants.
Now, the author's going to tell you what the Moors look like. Mm-hmm. This is historical.
Boy, yeah.
It was not. The reins of their horses were as fire. Their faces as black as pitch.
What? The Moors was what?
The reins of their horses were as fire. Their faces black
wait,
as
wait,
pitch.
Wait a minute. They was pitch black.
That's what they said.
Wait a minute. So the Moors were pitch black. They ain't no Arab. wait a minute.
That's right.
I want to be pitch black. You know, you get so black, even the shadow can point you out. That's what pitch black means. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Now they pitch black. We know the Moors are pitch black.
Uh-huh.
Wait a minute. This guy asked me, what's that about Moroccan, huh? Moroccans are what? Arabs and what?
Primarily Arabs.
Primary Arab and Berbers, right? Go ahead.
Yes,
and them were same people. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Their horses were swift as leopards. And their riders fiercer than a wolf and the sheep fold at night. The noble gods were broken in an hour, quicker than a tongue can tell. O luckless Spain. On through Spain marched the victors over the Pyrenees, mountains, and into the Frances. As you read, they were defeated by their Charles Martel at the Battle of Tours in 732.
All right, Islam, now check it. Nah.
That'll make a beautiful movie.
This is fine. You know, no way with the long ships. When I come up, Sidney Poitier played them all.
Mm-hmm.
Called the long ships.
Morgan Freeman.
Yeah, Morgan Freeman, but yeah, he played one straight up. But see, Sidney Poitier was the head.
Mm-hmm.
He was the leader. He had Arabs, everybody under him.
I'm gonna be honest and tell that whole story though on most pictures, that'd have to be a series.
Yeah, that'd
have
to be a series.
Serious.
So mm-hmm. So the brother said, so I just did one with two books. With two books, I went to the library, right? Prophet said what? Let me see what the prophet said again, because I don't want nobody to think I made it up. Because everybody would think I'm making stuff up. Very first page, fifth page. What shall we call it? The prophet said, probably 2 hours in an up-to-date library, huh? Did I just bust that mystery out? One country in Africa, so why are we all Moors and not Moors from Morocco? Now, that really got me because in here, let me read this again, because maybe I'm wrong. Maybe key 14 don't say what I said. Maybe I'm just crazy.
So he's the head that's teaching these other
people. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It says here, check this out. Says here, at the bottom, key 14, why are we Moorish Americans? Because we are descendants of Moroccans and born in America. What did he just ask me?
Is he questioning the prophet, man?
He can't be questioning me because, listen. What is meant when they say we get Jesus from the East? Did Jesus live in the West? This would be stupid. Where Jesus live at? Where Jesus live at? No, he lived in the Midwest.
South.
He lived in the Midwest. He lived between the East and the West. He lived in mid something. He lived not in the East nor the West. He lived in Midway.
Chicago.
Yeah. See, this is what I'm saying. I love my brother, but listen,
When I ask somebody come over 15 questions, I'm talking about 15 intelligent questions based on your literature. It got to be based on your literature. Now, what else to say? What is the correct side the Moroccan and American flag should be set up on, as in different temples?
You mean what?
He said, what is the correct side the Moroccan flag should be set up on, as it is different in different temples?
The Moroccan flag?
I don't know what the Moroccan flag looks like.
I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is.
Morocco didn't start flying the Moorish flag to 1956. Before that, they had the flag in 45. If you get old encyclopedias with pictures in it, it was a red flag with an interlocking circle around the green star. I know that because I used to have that dictionary.
They must be following Pleasant Bay stuff, yeah, too.
Not just that, they're not looking at any one-on-one. The problem is specifically asked what kind of a flag is the Moorish.
Right. Now, see, this is the thing. They got too many people there with too many opinions. They ain't sticking with the prophet.
Mm-hmm.
See, Moors don't stick with, but they're not the only ones. Hey, I used to think Kirkman Bay was the man. Come to find out, he wasn't nothing. He was a thief. So, now, if we look at this, what is the Moroccan flag? Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Is there anybody got a picture how the prophet set it up? The best way to go is to imitate I, the prophet. That's what he said. He didn't say follow Ra'il. He said I, the prophet. So let's see how the prophet set his flag up in his office. Now you got, now listen, you can't get no better than that. How did the prophet set his flag up in his office? Let me see if I got a picture down here. Okay, that's not it. Give me a...
in the controversy, you have it down.
My controversy is upstairs. I should have something here, though. Wait a minute, I can find something with it in there. Maybe it's in one of the school books. Let me look. Now, that's a hell of a question. Now, the simple way to do that is let's see how the prophet said he is up. Because he had offers, he took pictures. I said, what did brother tell me? See, he got fringes on the flag. See, they had no fringes on the flag to 1930, to after the New Deal, and that's how they had it. I'm like, they had fringes put around. That means that's a C flag. I was like, brother, maybe I'm crazy, but I could swear to God that Prophet Noble Jolly has in his office the American flag to his left and the Moorish flag to his right. Now, I could explain to you why that is, but then I have to kill you because you're going to try to teach somebody something you don't know. See? I got one of the pictures around there somewhere. See? I ain't got stuff for children. I ain't through it. I got coloring books for your children. See? So now, we have to ask ourselves. You talking about in different temples. Hell, people in different temples talking eating pork. Some don't eat pork.
They're facing the east.
Yeah, they face the east. Some of them scratch their booty and digging their nose through the conversation and rubbing on stuff. But that has nothing to do with the prophet. See, this is the catch. Everybody think of somebody say they a sheep. That's the line. Prophet didn't make everybody sheets. See, the people that came after the prophet sold out for that. Made everybody a sheik and sneaking. ETC. See? Then you stop voting. I like this. I like that. You know? See, and this is why you got to get
real Moorish leadership. Mm-hmm. Y'all got to come away from that flam stuff. Y'all really do. I mean, y'all got to quit. Y'all really got to quit, brothers. You don't like me because I'm too harsh, and I got to be harsh because you come to me stupid. Think about that. I'm sitting up here trying to teach you something, but you argue with me, but this is the first time you heard it. Don't you know that's your devil? Do you know that's your devil talking? Your devil said, oh, no, we can't have you listening to this, Joe. Oh, that Negro, that'll get you smart. I'm your devil. You got to listen to me. If you're going to believe in someone, why not believe in me? That's what the devil said. You got it? Now, let me show you.
And get the book.
Yeah. See that? What's on here, Isis? Huh? Looking for photos, videos. What you do? I'm going to tell you, I really don't care about you being mad at me anywhere in the world. You know why? Because when Allah called me to him, he's going to say, you did a good job. You made them Negroes mad. You made them Negroes mad. You made them so mad. Listen, next time somebody talk to them, they don't say that dumb stuff no more. Ain't that something? I make you so mad, you don't say that dumb stuff no more. You heard them quick change to something else. I'm looking forward to it. And I found the other one this morning, the one with the 1,600 pages. And what I did was I left room on the side so you can mark in it. So you can put your own markings in it. See? I'm looking for it. Just wait a minute. I'm going to get it. When I get it, I got the bigger picture of it. They don't show the whole flag. I got to get the picture to show the whole flag. That's what I'm calling. Oh, here it is. Up! Show this. Show that, man. Get up, man. Do something. Bring it up closer. Closer, closer, closer. Now, who should you be imitating? Who put the flags up? Joe Splittingate? I don't think so.
Well, you know R. Jones Bay put the
flag. Well, I don't care about R. Jones Bay. I don't care about Kirkman Bay. I don't care about Raya when it comes to the prophet. See, no, I don't care about you. I'm like Pig B. Martin. He comes to judge. Hey, I give myself 100 years. You know you can't do nothing wrong. I give myself 100 years of doing nothing. So you know you got my court talking about something. You too. You did what, young man? Hell. Just think about it. All right, let me get to the next question. Let me see. Now, we can't be upset at the brother because nobody's taught them, but they ain't trying to teach themselves. Okay, now here go four. Why is Acts 6 and 7 of the additional law repeated in the divine constitution and bylaw? Now they wonder, ooh, prophesied it twice. Ooh, prophesied it twice. Ooh, prophesied it twice.
A pondering
question. No. That's a good question, though. See, it's a good question because I'm wondering. Why? It ain't 14 Acts. It ain't but 12. Because two repeat themselves. But what is the two that repeat themselves? The most important parts of the thing. That's the most important of the thing. You can't get no important in Acts 6 and 7. Mm-hmm. What do you mean, Brother Ryan? Acts 6 with us. You ain't with us, F you.
You ain't over here with us doing this shit. You ain't with the prophet. You ain't following the prophet's teaching. I don't want nothing to do with you. You know, you ain't ever see Raya in the house full of faggots. Unless somebody give me $1 million, I'm going to pick my money up. Then I'm gone.
It was, we got into it one time in the Crips, and they were saying,
talk louder. Keep your hands off your mouth. Talk.
Get praise with a lot of honest to the prophet. We was in the Crips one time, and we was going over that. It was Moors that was pointing out that it was saying Moor Science Temple of America and the Divine Constitution and the Bylaws and Moor Science Temple in addition.
It's the same. But they petty. See, you know how Satan didn't come and get us out of Africa. We was already divided. We was giving that up. Mm-hmm. Just like right now, the prophet gave us everything we need and we gave it up to satisfy law sale. Kirkman Bay, he didn't tell nobody what happened in Cuba. The government gave him 2 pistols and a badge. Ain't nobody figured that stuff out. Why in the 20s he got 2 pistols and a badge? And then his death is a mystery. But when you go find out that he was sitting in the club getting high with some muftis, they were getting drunk. Somebody came to them and told him, and when they came, he flashed his badge on. And they told him that badge ain't no good no more. Step outside. And they took his pistols from him. Now who could do that but the police? Mm-hmm. Could no brothers come in there with them so-called, them muftis beat people halfway to death, Mr. Mm-hmm. Kirkman Bay. But they didn't do nothing to that white man. See, when that European stepped that day on him, and they look, the mufti died. Listen. They let him take him outside and beat the hell out of him. Listen, when they found out, when the police found out who the muftis run off. They run off. Mm. People heard him screaming and stuff. They called the police. The police came and surrounded the body. Mm-hmm. All laying on the streets. They wouldn't let nobody touch until the Moors came. They wanted, he didn't want to go. He said, I'm not going to the hospital. He refused to go to the hospital. Why do you think all of a sudden he got a mystery death? Everybody know how the prophet died, but don't nobody know how Kirkman Bay. They make Kirkman Bay better than the prophet, but don't nobody see it. Oh, he died a mysterious death. He got his butt kicked. Ain't nothing to, this is a size 30 shoe going up a size 1 hole.
We got it from
the people that was there, that was around there. So anyway, he refused to go to the hospital. We used to talk about this in the temple up there in Chicago. And the reason he refused because he knew they'd kill him in the hospital. Just like now, they're talking about they killed Martin Luther King in the hospital. They smothered him with a pull. That's what they're saying now. Because he knew he'd get in the hospital, they'd kill you. They're going to say whatever story they want to say. He died in January 1959, 30 years after he's known. See, them Europeans are smart. See, they take their little Uncle Tom, their little soldiers. They protect them for year in, year out. Because why they protecting you? They covering up their tracks. Mm. I went to the Pan American Union building. I looked for the Pan American 6th Annual Convention. They didn't have it in the building, the whole building. I had people searching the whole building. We went down there to the archive. They had 5 and 7. They did not have 6. We went to the archives. One of the people,
And she said, this is strange.
That's what she said. She said, this is strange. So I don't understand it. One of the people from the council was there. And they said, what? They said, no, it took me downstairs. Whole lot of leather covered books. Took me down there. Mm-hmm. Me and the Mo. Thompson Bay. And they went from 5 to 7. Wasn't no 6. Mm-hmm. Wasn't no 6. I wrote up there in New York where we went to in Washington. They keep all the records at
Library of Congress.
Library of Congress had 3,000 pages. They were supposed to send me 300 pages free. They cost 15 cents a page or 25 cents a page at that time. But they said because I'm a researcher, they would send me 30 pages. Never got the 30 pages. Never, never, ever, ever, ever. When I talked to the Moroccan embassy, I got that paper around here. They wanted to make me a Moroccan. Yes, they did. They said, Mr. Hill, we're going to make you a Moroccan. Send me the paperwork. I got the paperwork. It's in French and Spanish. I said, why in the hell an Arab country whose national tongue is Arabic, why would you send me something in French? Because this kid, I spoke Arabic. That's not I spoke Arabic. But they sent me two different things. Matter of fact, I think I even got a copy of one of the things in here. That's why this book is so important, because you can find things. You can find some of the things that they sent me from the embassy.
All the leaders of temples got that book.
Yeah, they don't even know most of the leaders got this book. Read that, bro. What'd that say? Read that page. 556. Read 556.
All right, 556.
First show, because I want to see so they can see I ain't joking. Buy the book, you can see it.
Buy the book.
All right, read it.
I, Embassy of the Kingdom of Morocco, Washington, D.C., Cultural Section 1601, 21st Street, Washington, D.C., 2009. Mr. Ra'il, 357 Jones Street, San Francisco, California, 94102, April 26, 1994. Dear Sir, Please find and close the information about the Kingdom of Morocco, information on King Hassan II, history, and the Moroccan naturalization process. I'm sorry, but we have this information available in Arabic and French only. I hope that this information will be useful to you. If you need further assistance, do not hesitate to contact the cultural section by phone or by fax at the following numbers. Telephone 202.
I didn't read the phone number.
Oh, no. Thank you for your interest in Morocco.
Yeah. And that's a 94. It'll be what, 30 years next year? I'm way ahead of y'all.
My brother wasn't even born yet.
Your brother wasn't even born yet. But anyway. So, next question. But let me answer it. The reason that they repeat it, sir, because they're the most important questions. How you become a Moorish American? How you maintain being a Moorish American? To be a Moorish American, you're a family, but you got to take care of your family. That's what Act 7 say. Keep lying all the same. That means you got to do everything the prophet required. But you don't want to do that because you're a Christian. Mm-hmm. Pardon me. Now here go number 5. Why do Moors observe Ramadans?
Why do?
Yeah. Here you always wonder why you're a Moor in the first place. Then you wonder why you get the East, named from the East. Then you wonder about the flag. I'm going to tell you why we celebrate Ramadan. Let me read you the prophet stuff. I love when y'all have me read the prophet stuff. I don't even be mad with you when y'all got me reading the prophet stuff. You know, y'all got me reading the prophet stuff. And as soon as I get to reading the prophet stuff, I feel so good. Now, this is, see that Moorish guy? And this is what it says. We of the Moorish Science Temple of America, like countless other American citizens, know that we must live together here in America in harmony, friendship, and goodwill. Whatever our race or creed may be, it is only from the pure religious standpoint it seems at this time that we differ from a large number of our fellow Americans. We believe in and foster the Muslim religion. We believe in the principles of teaching it as so far as they can be adopted to the American life. As far as I can adopt to the American life, that's the key. So, why don't you Ramadan, brothers? If it can be adopted to American life, why don't you? What's your reason not to? Our reason is we got the Quran in October. The prophet turned around and he selected October, not Ra'il. First convention held October 15, 1928. First charter issued out of the Moorish Scientific America, October 15, 1920. Oh, I see a pattern in there. I'm following the bouncing ball. Pa-ping, 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 pa-ping. I'm following the bouncing ball. Prophet said October 15, 1925. He established the first temple. Then pa-ping, pa-ping, pa-ping. The ball's up. First convention. Put that up there. Show that. I even got it on my wall. Just flip that big camera. Flip your camera. See that? Very first convention. I'm following the bouncing ball. How come you aren't? Okay. Yeah, back on me perfectly. So, let's go to the next one. Why does white mean purity mean God, God means ruler of the land, when the Webster Dictionary defines purity as the quality, state of pure being? Wait. You skipped the word white. Now, I just read this stuff about white, right? White boy. White boyism. White. It says purity, right? They got to get up to the library. Because they ain't looking in the dictionary. Because it said white means purity. But then all what it says, and God means ruler of the land. And when Webster Dictionary defines purity as the quality of state of pure being. Wait a minute. So God impure? So God impure? That's what they say. I don't understand this question. Why does white mean purity?
They trying to associate it with white people.
Yeah, that's what they
No, no. They associate it with everything but the prophet. That's their problem. You comparing everything but the prophet. That's because you're still a Christian. You're a Christianized more. You're a Jewishized more. You're a Hebrewized more. You're a Nation of Islamized more. You're a white boy Rick, white boy more. You're everything but what the prophet brought. Don't be mad at me. Look at yourself. You could have went to a library and found out. So they found the library. Now they say Webster, right? Him in the dictionary again. Show it. I didn't know what they say.
So Webster.
Well, it ain't no Webster, is it? No, it ain't no Webster.
Second edition.
It's a unibridge.
It ain't no, wait a minute. What they say, they Webster say white what? They say that dictionary say white means purity. Oh, yeah. Let me see.
Upgrade your dictionary.
That's the second edition.
Yeah, this is the second edition.
That's a unibridge, though. That should have almost everything. You just got to update his Webster. Up to date Webster.
Let me find out about white again. Because obviously, he's saying me in the prophet line. See, when you get a chief, what's that brother say in his dictionary? He said that Set means Moabite, king of the Moabite. Remember the nigga the one that told us that Set means Moabite?
Yeah.
He gonna say, no, Cain and Abel and his son Set means king of the Moabites. I said, brother, where you getting that from? Out of my concordance. I said, you got a concordant
nut. You mugs, bro.
You mugs. Concordant. I don't even know. Okay, let me look at white here. Let me go for white again.
Maybe you want to stick something in there to keep it that page.
Gosh, oh,
my. You got to go back to it.
I go back to it. It's good. I like going back to work for a month. I can help him out. White face, white hand. Let me see. White. Let me just see what the word white means. White. White. White got three pages.
Yeah.
White. Whiter, super, whitest. White. Having the color of pure snow or milk. Wait a minute. He just said, why I say purity, right? And what he just said? Mm-hmm. Did he just say what? Did he just say? It says white. I guess I'm going to close this because this dictionary too big. Put that back up there. This dictionary. Look, I think this dictionary at. Mm-hmm. See, we have a saying in Chicago. Why bring the weakest stuff to the strongest man? I'm 70-something years old. I've been studying 50 years. I got 50 years worth of study from teachers that was with the prophet or teachers that could have been with the prophet. Okay, what else he said here? Let me see. What's the
last? I thought it was the last.
No, that ain't the last. The last question. I'm trying to figure out what I did deal with. What the, oh, yeah. The last question is this here. Was Marcus Garvey a registered Moor?
Is John the Baptist a part of Jesus?
I know John the Baptist was a Christian.
You know what I'm saying?
I thought he was a Baptist.
Was he a registered Moor?
He's stunning Desmond Cripps, isn't he?
Yeah. See, a lot of Moors. I've seen some pictures where they had some Moors with Marcus Garvey had a white turban on, and his name was Garvey Bay. All that's bull. Prophet never said he was a Moor. Prophet didn't say he wasn't a Moor either. Marcus Garvey said he needed a nationality. He was that Japanese, Germany, and German. Marcus Garvey's son said he wasn't part of the Moor Scientific America. Marcus Garvey's son is still alive, unless he even died. But anyway, what difference does it make? See, your sympathizers don't have to be like you. Prime example. Who is that European? John Brown. His sons and them died to set us free. They was Europeans. They took up the gun and stuff, went to kill people to keep us alive. Now, the Supreme Court at that time, 1857, has said a black man has a right that a white man has to recognize. John Brown and his sons went and got pistols and more people and tried to set us free. They got busted up there in Illinois at Harper's Ferry. Now, were they Negroes or Negro sympathizers? Now, since they were sympathizers, they were Negroes to the enemy.
John the Baptist didn't follow Jesus.
They're not scripture. You can't make brothers say this is the thing. I was called to do this. They wasn't. Let's get this straight. I was called to teach. I had the infinite experiences to back me. I was called. This is why George Cookman told him, I know what the prophet told me, who the prophet told me to look for. See, I've had the experience. Allah wakes me up. Allah lays me down. Allah shows me how. That's what it means they call. I'm not like them Christians. Christians call themselves. They just wake up, masturbate, how God called me. I had a good feeling. Finger themselves, God called me. Or they look good and they got something to say. God called me. But that ain't how I got mine. See, all of them that have been called by God and the devil's still here, something wrong. You can go in one city and find 20 people, Christian, called by God. Out to 20, five of them got mega churches, and everybody's starving. Man living a multi-million dollar home. It's just like TJ, is that TJ? Jakes. TDJ. Yeah, TDJ just brought a homosexual, the man married to a man that's a governor and stuff, and talking about you, my friend. You know, you're doing a wonderful job. And the Europeans say that nigga can't even be a man. Now, Europeans say, wait a minute, let me show you. A European is talking about TDJ bringing European because he's still a slave. A lot of Moors are still slaves. They have not yet, I would say masturbate. They have not got the devil off of him yet. See. Where is it at? I was so, I can't say it, taken back, but this European called TJJ or Uncle Tama. This European. Now you know you off the track when the master's son say you Uncle Tama.
But you see what T.D. Jakes did last Sunday? He brought Beto O'Rourke to his church. Oh, Beto. Guy's married to a man. Has an adopted baby because men can't get pregnant and have one. Hates America. Loves socialism. Loves communism. Believes in full-blown abortion on demand. Thinks there's more sexes and genders than you can shake a stick at. Don't even know what bathroom to use. And T.D. Jakes brings him to the church, shakes his hand, endorses, talks about what a great upstanding man, what a great governor he would make for the. And my question is, why do you even say such stupid stuff out of your mouth? I'll tell you why. They can't say anything against the system because they're owned by the system. They're owned by the system. T.D. Jakes on this race bait nonsense, talking about slavery, slavery. And guess what? T.D. Jakes is a slave to the system.
And he dropped the mic.
That came from a cave.
European telling on him. That's crazy. What a difference a day makes. Mm-hmm. Simple 24 hours. But it might not be such a bad idea if Jake never went home. Some say kick it, quit it, but have you ever tried? All right.
It was all Kareem, just trying to watch a little bit.
Okay, Isis. Almighty, come on, close that. The Europeans say TD Jakes sold out.
That's serious.
Huh? That's serious.
That's
the Europeans say TD Jakes is still a slave to the system.
That was deep. Real quick, we want to extend our Islams to Brother Kareem. It's beautiful to see you be able to just.
Where is he at?
I seen him post up on the thing.
Who's that other guy?
I don't know. The visitors.
Well, that's right. Just leave him alone. Don't worry about
it. So we want to just say Islam to you, and we got our prayers surrounding you and our Sheikh is Amani, and we trust to hear from you. We're going to reach out to you over the weekend. Praise Allah. All right, we want to go ahead and close out. If you want to learn more about us, you want to get the book, The Controversial Years.
You want to go to the up-to-date library? It's free. Listen, my homie said this here. Why don't you check out your mind? It's not against the law. It's right there on the shelf. Why don't you check it out for yourself? Check out your mind. Check out your mind. Check out your mind.
Absolutely.
Check out your mind. Curtis Mayfield. Don't move that. That's all my stuff.
That's a show the book.
Don't show the book. They know to get it.
MoorishIslamicStore.com. Get right. The book and other things.
So and if you slow, just send me 200 and I keep it.
Islam.
For writing it up for you. Because I'm going to tell you, check out your mind. Something that's not against the law is right there on the shelf.
We have some more to read the law, put it on your heart. We always accept donations, Cash App, or go on our website. And we got a donation button, take you directly to PayPal. Cash App is MSTA 1928. And our website is msta1928.org. And we always want to extend our Islam to those who continue to support what we do. Mm-hmm. Praise Allah. So we're going to go ahead and close out. Allah, bind our hearts and minds back to our ancient forefathers, divine creed and principles. We ask this in the holy name and of the seven Elohim. Amen. Oh, hush up.
No, she's saying her Islam. She's saying Islam. Tell them.
Islam, fam.
Tell me.
Islam. Thank you for being the best part of what we do, and that is to inform, educate, and uplift. We welcome you to learn more about us, join our mailing list, or perhaps you are seeking to become a member of our community. We invite you to visit our website at msta1928.org. You would also find a host of various publications to aid in your understanding about the history and faith of Islam from a Moorish American perspective at the MoorishIslamicStore.com. Make sure to subscribe to our channel to be informed of our regular scheduled programs. May Allah go before you. We leave you in the best of ways, peace and love, in praises to Allah Almighty.